Now, this is my friend Marty Byers, and I just met him maybe a year ago or something, something like that. Mm-hmm. And we fell in, and now we're best friends. He's kind of powerful. He's one of the elites. So I fell. But we have become good friends. His mom and daddy are really what Holly said. Every time I come home, that she thinks what's really getting me over there is your mama, because I always come home with Marty's mama.
Mama's story. Cooking.
Her cooking or something mama she cooking. Said that was funny or something. Yeah. So.
They're good folks.
Yeah, they're not bad folks for sure. Yep, it's fun hanging around them.
We're talking about family. This do one about family.
Okay.
Being a D.
Wait, what do we do?
Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. You know it?
Yep.
While the world looks upon me as I struggle along, and they say I have nothing, but they are so wrong. In my heart I'm rejoicing, how I wish they could see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. There's a roof up above me, I've a good place to sleep, and there's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. I know I'm not wealthy, and these clothes, they're not new. I don't have much money, but Lord, I have you. And that's all that matters, though the world may not see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. There's a roof up above me, I've a good place to sleep, and there's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me.
So you got a different background from most of my friends. Where'd you come from? Does a person like you come from?
Texarkana. So grew up in Texarkana.
Lower Arkansas,
LA. Can't you tell by the accent?
No. You sound a little just like you're from here.
All right.
Sort of. You know, I don't notice that my accent's any different from people around here until I'm around somebody from central Louisiana. And then I all of a sudden I feel this kinship inside. You know how sometimes you just hear something and it just sounds like your people.
Well, people from Louisiana, they're not normal. So I see how you fit in.
Yeah, that's my papa. I was around a guy named Dennis Elliott, I met him at a bluegrass festival. And turns out he looks like my papa first. I was looking at him. I was like, man, I just want to tell you, you look just like my papa. He said, well, where is he from? And it turns out he's from central Louisiana. His wife went to the same school as my grandmother did. So, like, they probably are kinfolks, which is why I felt that kinship.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. Louisiana.
Yep. So you've been playing music very long. You've got some talent. You have some talent.
Very little. I was dating this girl, and on the very first date, we had a blind date, and we had lunch, and I guess about 2.5 hours into lunch, she said, "I hate to leave, but I've got to go." I said, "My mother, I'm helping her, and she plays with the group, and they had just what you would call a guitar pool or a guitar jam." We continued to see one another, and I ended up at one of those and tried to play the piano, but the left hand won't work.
Well, you need both hands to play the guitar, yeah, too.
So, but I can make the left hand do a little bit of what I want, but not on the piano. Mm.
The guitar is a good choice.
Yeah.
It's way more social. Piano's not really a social instrument.
Well, that's
instrument.
True. It's a lot easier to carry a guitar.
That's for sure.
The warden led a prisoner down a hallway to his doom. I stood up to say goodbye like all the rest. I heard him tell the warden, "There's a just..."
We're going to have to start that over.
I was kidding.
I wanted to go in that second verse of bad.
The warden led a prisoner down a hallway to his doom. I stood up to say goodbye like all the rest. I heard him tell the warden just before he reached my cell, "Let my guitar playing friend do my request. Let him sing me back home with a song I used to hear, and make my old memories come alive. Take me and turn back the years. Sing me back home before I die." I recall last Sunday morning, a choir from off the street came in to sing a few old gospel songs. And I heard him tell the singers, "There's a song my mama sang. Could I hear it once before you move along? Won't you sing me back home with a song I used to hear, and make my old memories come alive? Take me away and turn before I die."
I play with Marty at his house every now and then, over at his house, and there's like it's an acoustic, and it's kind of a show. But I guess you've been doing that kind of thing for a long time.
Oh, yeah, I've been involved at it from that angle from probably 10, 12 years, maybe, just having to get together.
Right. That's pretty neat. Yeah. I enjoy it.
Yeah.
Thing is kind of nearly lost.
You create a lot of friendships.
Yeah, and you do, especially for a certain demographic of people who yes. don't really have a place anymore other than church to a social thing. No. You know, the kind of church I grew up in, they don't have that kind of church anymore.
No.
That's that style of music that has that kind of culture built into it. The music now in the church culture is all about young and about the worship music, the rock based music. And that doesn't appeal to me at all.
No, we go, we're all classic country and some old country gospel.
Mm-hmm. I do most of the gospel that's done, to be honest. All them hotshot Christians that come up there, and I, the heathen that I am, I have to do the gospels.
Well, you can, but me having a honky tonk background, I'll do a honky tonk than a gospel.
I got a little bit of that background too. But you get, I like them songs you do though. Those are good old songs that I don't hear anymore.
Yeah,
it brings them back to mind.
Yeah, it's all old classic. Goes back some of it to the 20s with Jimmy Rogers. My dad is a huge Jimmy Rogers fan.
I think. Well, a lot of the people that are my heroes were Jimmy Rogers fans. As far as like their music is based on his music, so when I and a lot of them is like doing those same songs, like Jimmy Rogers and like what is it, the Blue Yodels, all those Blue Yodels, mm-hmm. like those are done. People do those on bluegrass stages all the time, even now.
Oh yeah, and tell you a connection, Hank Thompson mm-hmm. was a Jimmy Rogers fan.
Hell, he was,
and. I heard him make the comment one time that ever so often in his office, he had to pull out his Jimmy Rogers collections and play a series of Jimmy Rogers songs.
Yeah. It kind of takes you back to the thing you, mm-hmm. what your roots or the basis of what you of your musicianship.
You bet.
Yeah. You know, the bottom of it. It's good to get back to that.
Yep.
So honky tonk background, you talking about you being in a honky tonk?
I've been in one or two. Yeah. If I want my mom to know that, I'll tell her.
Okay. So we delete this, Holly.
But I got to be friends with Hank Thompson, a friend of mine, and I...
friends with Hank Thompson, you said?
Yes. Hank Thompson was a great guy, and a friend of mine and I produced 5 country music concerts, and Hank Thompson was the headliner, along with Freddie Hart, and got to be very good friends with Hank Thompson. One of the funniest stories about Hank, we were playing on the Arkansas-Mississippi line, and he was headed back home. He lived in Roanoke, Texas, and he had driven to that concert, he and his wife, Ann. And I called my mother, and I told her I was bringing some people home for lunch and told her what to cook, I'd ask them what they like, what they might want for lunch. And when mother opened the back door and there stood Hank Thompson and his wife for lunch, that was a treat for my mother and daddy. And
I bet it was.
Mother made the comment during the lunch. She said, I've listened to you on the radio when I was a little girl. I've seen you on television, but I never thought that you'd be sitting at my kitchen table. He was a genuine, sincere, great person.
He seemed like he would be.
Yes. He was a good guy, nice guy. So was Freddie Hart.
Isn't that something?
Good people.
And so how long did you know him? And
I think we did those concerts, if I'm not mistaken, in the year 2000.
He just passed just recently, didn't he?
He passed...
18?
No.
Was it longer ago than
yeah,
that?
Yeah. I didn't know that. Yeah, he died back in the 2008, 7, 9, somewhere around in there, I think. But he had he was going to perform a show in Gilmer, and we were getting ready to leave, and his wife called and said the show's been canceled, and he had had a stroke, and they put him in the hospital in Tyler under an assumed name, and they went in with a new procedure and corrected the aneurysm in his head there. But he did several shows in East Texas, and we would always go and be a part of that with him.
But those, you said you did 5 shows, 8 shows? How many did you say you did?
We did 5.
As far as being 5.
We did 5 concerts.
And that's the only 5 concerts? You never wanted to be a promoter?
No.
Deal with
that? That'll either make you or break you. And that was when we decided that we weren't made out to do that kind of work.
Seems like it would be fun, but I don't know.
It is, but it's nerve-wracking.
Yeah, it seems like it would be kind of you're on the line kind of thing.
All this is set up. You've got this much money spent. Yeah. Is it coming
and it's
in?
Spent.
Yeah, is it coming through the door or not?
Yeah, that seems like that would be. And whether you like music or not, I mean that's a whole different thing than music.
That's a money making.
Yeah,
but through that process, I think we we were able to, it was for charity. And we were able to put about $30 million indirectly back into the economy of the state of Arkansas because we were raising the money for sheltered workshops for mentally and physically handicapped adults.
Oh.
And because that was one, we were associated with a nonprofit giving money to another nonprofit, then that upped the percentage that the federal government matched. So it was a very good thing.
That's pretty neat.
Yeah, very good thing.
So what is your favorite Hank Thompson song?
Probably Wild Side of Life.
Probably.
Probably.
You're not sure?
Without a doubt.
That probably would be, without a doubt.
He's got a lot. But,
he does. That's a good one.
After one of the concerts that we did, we were having a guitar jam, and I just chose to sing Hank Thompson's Wild Side of Life to Hank Thompson.
Looking at him just like this?
Looking at him right just like I'm looking at you.
Yeah, that's something.
Yeah, he was a good guy.
That takes a certain kind of person to do that.
Yeah, brave. Or stupid. Or stupid.
You wouldn't read my letter if I wrote you. You asked me not to call you on the phone. But there's something I'm wanting to tell you. So I wrote it in the words of the song. I didn't know God made honky-tonk angels. I might have known you'd never make a wife. You gave up the only one that ever loved you and went back to the wild side of life. The glamour of the gay night lights have lured you to the places where the wine and liquor flow, where you wait to be anybody's baby and forget the truest love you'll ever know. I didn't know God made honky-tonk angels. I might have known you'd never make a wife. You gave up the only one that ever loved you and went back to the wild side of life. You went back to the wild side of life.
I like these songs you pick.
Oh, that's just old standards.
Hmm. Not for me. Let's talk about your guitar. That's one thing we hadn't talked about. That thing is pretty.
Thank you.
It's like got a cherry sunburst kind of finish. What kind of guitar is it and how long have you had it?
That's a Bedell, and I've had it about a year.
Hmm. Have I known you that long? Because when I first started hanging around, you were playing a Fender, kind of the similar sort of color. It was kind of just a red, though.
About a year.
About a year.
Yeah. Not that long.
Has it changed any? They said them those because the Bedell's not a like it. You don't really buy them off a shelf. They're kind of a custom.
It has
handmade it's, kind of thing.
Yeah, it's changed. And I wanted a red guitar, so they had it.
It's pretty.
The story on the Bedell is, I found out a place that they sold them, and Harold Lynn told me that he went by there, and he wanted one so bad he couldn't stand it. So I went up there and bought one
because he wanted it.
Just so that he'd know that I had one.
Mm. Well, that worked out.
So when I die, it'll be his, and he he's praying for me to have an early death.
Well, that's always nice. That thing is pretty. I even like the headstock. There's nothing ornate on the.
No.
Sometimes I put an inlay right here.
Yeah.
But that figuring on that wood's so pretty.
Yeah.
Like, you don't need anything.
It's just, it's kind of like a tux. It's pretty straightforward.
It's nice.
Thank you. It's,
and it sounds, I played it when you first got it, And I played it a couple of weeks ago, and it has changed a lot. I didn't know if you could tell.
It changes.
It's like it's filling out. Yeah. It's a lot richer than it was at the beginning.
Man, Harold Lynn found another guitar the other day, and I bought it, and it's an old Gibson, and it really sounds good.
Mm. How old?
I really don't know. I think it's about 15, maybe 20 years old.
Yeah, that's old enough.
Where it's in the ballpark. Mm-hmm. So, but it's a replica of a Woody Guthrie. That's what it is.
They nice still make those.
Nice guitar.
Oh, they did up to just pretty recently. Yeah. They still make those Woody Guthrie models.
Yeah.
Right there on the end.
That's a good song.
I do. I heard Jimmy Martin do that song.
Yeah, that's a good song. I think everybody in the world's done that.
I love that song. What are we doing now? Hungry Eyes.
You gonna do that?
Well, it's on the list.
Okay.
But that's a C song.
It's a C.
And so I'm gonna have to get this guitar for that.
I guess I can pretend to play banjo. I play banjo in C.
No, Merle Haggard, she's a banjo player on Mama's Hungry Eyes.
The way I'm gonna play this is a little like a banjo. I don't need this. We're gonna have to get in tune though. This thing sounds like a toy compared to a real guitar.
Sounds good.
You know, it's got kind of it's good for finger picking and stuff. It doesn't have much bass.
Buck Owens guitar.
Mm-hmm.
You're getting a blind man. Chords for that glass.
Especially looking past that microphone.
Yeah.
A canvas covered cabin in a crowded labor camp stands out in this memory I recall. My daddy raised a family there with two hard working hands. and tried to feed my mama's hungry eyes. He dreamed of something better, and my mama's faith was strong. But us kids were just too young to realize that another class of people put us somewhere just below. One more reason for my mama's hungry eyes. Mama never had the luxury she wanted, but it wasn't 'cause my daddy didn't try. She only wanted things she really needed. One more reason for my mama's hungry eyes. I remember daddy praying for a better way of life, but I don't recall a change of any size. Just a little loss of courage as their age began to show, and more sadness in my mama's hungry eyes. Mama never had the luxury she wanted, but it wasn't 'cause my daddy didn't try. She only wanted things she really needed. One more reason for my mama's hungry eyes. I still recall my mama's hungry eyes.
Sweet little song.
That's a good song.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good song.
Mm-hmm. Merle Haggard had a bunch of them right there in that little window. Well, I mean, he had a bunch over 30 years, but there were a bunch of them in that window that kind of had that sound.
Yeah. Harold Lynn hates this song because it's got a funky timing. It's G, A minor.
Is this a G song? Am I playing a guitar on this song? What is it?
Yeah. G, A minor, D, but you're going to the C, too.
Just let me
play it.
Let me get a guitar that ain't D-tuned. What is this, A song? G song.
It's G.
Get my strap on. What kind of a person plays a guitar and don't wear a strap?
You looking at him.
So you've mentioned playing with a lead guitar player. In what context did you play with a lead guitar player?
The lead guitar player was as good as it gets, and he was a welder for the Kansas City Southern Railroad. Did not read music, played by ear.
Good lead guitar player don't need to, because they ain't playing along. They ain't playing what you're doing. They're singing anyway with
and
their fingers.
He was fantastic. Yeah. And in that same group played the guy that played keyboards, had played on the road with Mickey Gilley.
Really?
Yeah.
Did y'all play just, out anywhere?
Just for like community things and stuff like that. But, you know, it was just a normal Saturday night picking and just having fun.
I knew you ran into these elite circles.
No, not too elite. One of my favorite Merle Haggard songs, and it's a little different.
Seems like every November, when the weather gets bad, I start to remember all the good love we had. And the long nights get longer. I wish a friend would come by. But the forecast is zero. The chill factor's high. The chill factor's higher on a clear, windy day. But there's no wind this morning, and no wind on the way. There's a snowstorm inside me, where there's high record wind. Think I'm colder this morning than I've ever been. There's a snowstorm inside me, where there's high record wind. But there's no wind this morning. There's a snowstorm inside me, where there's high record wind. But the forecast is zero. The chill factor's high.
You ever heard that?
I like that, no? That's Merle Haggard?
Harold Lynn hates it.
Harold Lynn, so you, who's Harold Lynn? Tell us about Harold Lynn.
Harold Lynn's my adopted child.
Okay.
Harold Lynn, met Harold Lynn many years ago, and we formed a tight friendship and a bond, and I'll claim him as mine.
Well, I tell you, before I heard you claim him, I met you the same day I met him, and I thought there was a good chance that he was your son. And my friends that were there, they all, Carolyn and Joanne, they thought the same thing.
Yeah.
And so then we heard you claim it, and that I think there's a chance they still think that y'all are father and son. So you know,
he may be. Well, I'll claim him.
You might as well.
I'll claim him. Proud of him.
Yeah.
Make the world go away. I can get it off my shoulders. Say the things you used to say. And make the world go away. Do you remember when you loved me? Before the world took me astray. If you do, then forgive me and make the world go away. Make the world go away and get it off my shoulders. Say the things you used to say. Make the world go away. I'm sorry if I hurt you. I'll make it up day by day. Just say you love me like you used to and make the world go away. Make the world go away and get it off my shoulders. Say the things you used to say. Make the world go away. Say the things you used to say and make the world go away.
Good.
Gotta hit that note like who? Ray Price.
Yeah, that's who did it.
Yeah.
That's who did that version. Yeah. I wasn't expecting that.
I wasn't?
Mm-mm.
Threw it in on you. Surprised you.
Who else did it? Eddie Arnold?
Eddie Arnold, yeah, Jim Eddie Reeves.
Eddie Arnold don't do that.
No, Jim Reeves.
And Jim Reeves, too. Yeah. Jim Reeves is my favorite.
Yeah.
I don't want to get into any Jim Reeves, because then I'll jump to your daddy and telling secrets on your daddy.
We'll do a Jim Reeves.
Mm-hmm. What are you going to do with Jim Reeves?
Blue Side of Lonesome.
I don't know if I know that.
I'm calling to tell you it's over. Yes, darling, you're now free to go. You're saying you're sorry, you've hurt me, but you've hurt me much more than you know. Don't ask me where this gall comes from. Oh, I hope that you won't end up here. If your new romance turns out a failure, here's where you'll find me, my dear. I'm just on the blue side of lonesome, right next to the Heartbreak Hotel, in a tavern that's known as Three Teardrops, on a bar stool not doing so well. The floor has a carpet of sorrow, yet no one can weep in the aisle. And they say someone broke the bar mirror with only the ghost of a smile. The hands on the clock never alter, for things never change in this place. There's no present, no past, no future. We're the ones who have lost in love's race. I'm just on the blue side of lonesome, right next to the Heartbreak Hotel, in a tavern that's known as Three Teardrops, on a bar stool not doing so well.
That was fun to play.
That's Jim Reeves.
I love it.
That's
Jim
a good
Reeves.
Song.
Mm-hmm.
Good song. Good song.
Yep, I love that one.
He liked to drink whiskey and fight, too.
Is that something else he's had in common with your daddy?
No, daddy drank beer.
But did like to fight.
Yeah. No, Jim Reeves is probably one of the smoothest voices. His death was certainly a tragedy, but mm-hmm. From everything that you read or hear, he was a super person.
Right.
Died in that plane crash, but he's from this part of the country.
Is he? I didn't know that.
Yeah, he grew up in DeBerry.
Is that right?
And there's a big statue down there on the side of the highway for Jim Reeves. But he's
a professional baseball player.
Yes, too. He was. Still got a lot of fans.
He's got one in me.
When we play music, somebody wants to hear a Jim Reeves song.
Yeah. And you do him real well too. I
mean, thanks. He's easy to do.
Mm-hmm. That's true. I mean, he leaves a lot of room for.
Yeah.
Smooth and easy.
That's right. And it's the slower stuff. Of course, he had some faster stuff too, but He's just noted for his slower stuff.
Right. Yep. So when I met you, there's a couple stories I wanted to, and I wanted you to say something about Joanne and Carolyn, about Carolyn. She was supposed to go with us to a bluegrass festival, and I was talking to you, and you were saying that you asked me if we were leaving out that day, and I looked at my schedule, and I was confused because it was the week after. And then you talked to Carolyn a little later, and then you called me and told me the story about.
Well, Carolyn had car trouble, and she knew she was going on this trip.
Right.
So she just forced her mechanic to repair the car.
Right.
And this started on about a Monday, and the wrong part came in, and she was wanting to leave on a Wednesday.
Right.
And she was having him stand on her on his head. And she had cooked all kind of stuff to take on the trip with her.
Yeah.
And had that ready to go.
And this was the Wednesday of...
Yeah. That's right.
She was leaving on Thursday or Friday.
And he had gotten the other part in, and he was trying to get it on, and she was calling him about every 30 minutes, checking on that and driving him crazy because she was going berserk that she was not going to be able to make the festival. And then she found out after I had urged her to go back and check your calendar again, I think you got the wrong date. And she let loose with some choice. Well,
do you remember what she said?
I remember exactly what she said.
And maybe say it, and we could bleep it out.
Yeah, and she said, "And I've had this man standing on his head to get my car fixed. I've got chicken and dumplings and chicken salad made. Ain't this the shits?"
Oh my gosh! And this is a Christian woman.
Sing another gospel song, Carolyn. No, I went up there. I got a text from Fred to come up there and if we wanted to play at his place up there for that guitar pool or jam session on a cold, cold, windy February night. So we decided to go. Called Harold Lynn. He met us up there and another friend of mine from Hallsville. And we went.
Who's the other friend?
That was Neil Young.
Oh, that is right. You dragged Neil up there.
And we made a lot of friends that night, and that's almost a year.
It's hard to believe. It seems like I've known y'all longer than that.
Yeah,
but
made a lot of good friends.
Mm-hmm.
Good friends that night.
Yeah, it's been good. It's been a good year.
Yeah,
I played a lot of music this year. You know, I hadn't played a lot of music in the last 20 years, really. I mean, as far as with people, you know, I've always been kind of a closet musician more than anything. Just playing at home and. Writing songs, but
yeah, what we do is fun. There's no pressure,
right? Exactly.
And if you play professionally, you're going to work up a set, and you're going to
play that a thousand times,
and you're going to play to what your audience wants to hear. And when you have a guitar pull or a jam like we do,
right,
we play for us.
Right,
we're having fun, and there's a lot of people that do come, and they come to listen, and they're having a good time. But we're not mandated to play what they want to hear,
right?
So. And those people are happy with anything that you play that's old country music.
That's true.
They are happy with that.
Yeah, because you just don't hear it. You don't hear it on radio.
Mm-mm.
And those people don't. I mean, you can pull it up on YouTube, but those people that are 80 years old, generally they don't watch YouTube.
They don't do the computer.
No.
Let me tell you about a song, and we'll do it. This is Willie Nelson's probably one of the most prolific songwriters out there. He and Bill Anderson.
For sure.
I like some of Willie's stuff. Don't like all of it, but there was a period of time that he did some kind of just more modern stuff to me, but his classic country stuff is absolutely without question hard to beat. I heard this song on the radio going down the road, and I had somebody in the car with me, and I didn't get to listen to it as closely as I wanted. And I thought, I like that song. Forgot about it. 2 or 3 months later, I was driving down the road by myself, heard the song on the radio, and I thought, I've got to learn that song. That song has a message that is unbelievable. And in looking up the lyrics and the tabs for the song, I ran across a video of a guy singing the song, and Willie Nelson was accompanying him in a church. And the guy said, I don't know if this story is correct, but he recorded the song in 1957 or 58. Willie wrote the song in 1957.
Hmm.
This man was told by someone else that Willie wrote the song in 57 and recorded it. When he went back in the playback room with his producer and heard the song played back, he fell out of the chair and fell on the floor and said, "If I never write or record another song, this would be the highlight of my career."
Mm.
That's, to me, that speaks volumes coming from Willie Nelson and the message that the song brings.
Mm. So it's a gospel.
It's a gospel. Willie Nelson gospel.
You think you will? What are we going to play on this?
You can play that. I passed a home the other day. The yard was filled with kids at play, and on the sidewalk of this home, a little boy stood all alone, his smiling face was sweet and kind, but I could see the boy was blind. He listened to the children play. I bowed my head and there I prayed, "Dear Lord above, why must this be?" And then these words came down to me. After all, you're just a man, and it's not for you to understand. It's not for you to reason why you two are blind. Without my eyes, so question not what I command. It's not for you to understand. Now when I pray, my prayer is one. I pray His will, not mine, be done. After all, I'm just a man, and it's not for me to understand. So question not what God commands. It's not for us to understand.
Mm-hmm.
Good song.
I really do
like it. Good song. Well, the message yeah, it's really, of the song.
True, especially if you're a Presbyterian.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Well, you know what a Presbyterian is, don't you?
What's that?
That's a Baptist that can read.
That's a good one. You'd have to be able to read to be a Presbyterian, because who knows how to spell that?
Yeah, there's a lot of pomp and circumstance there.
Yeah, there is. Baptist that can read.
My favorite singer, I guess, would probably be Merle Haggard. I don't guess Merle Haggard's ever done a bad song.
He's your favorite singer, or he does your favorite songs? Because that's kind of a different thing.
I'm going to say it's the same. Really? Favorite singer, favorite song.
Is that right?
I'm a Merle Haggard man.
Well, it's hard not to be a fan of his. Yeah. You know, even for somebody like Holly, we were driving up to Arkansas and we heard one of Merle Haggard's songs. I can't remember which one it was now, but she like, and she had never heard the song. She said, "Who does that song? We need to be doing that." It's just like she had never heard it. And it's like all, but a lot of his songs are that. He's got 30 of them there that way.
Oh, yeah.
That for a person that's never heard them, if you, when you hear it, it just sounds, it's so soulful.
Yeah.
Like there's,
he wrote from the heart.
Yeah, he did.
You remember what the song was?
No, I can't remember. Holly, you remember what the song was? How did you meet Fred Gebhardt from the Kilgore Mercantile?
Okay. Before Fred moved to Kilgore, he and his wife,
Vivian,
lived in Hallsville. Mm. And the church asked me to sing at a senior citizens event. And Neil, that we referenced earlier, told me about Fred, that he lived in town and he played the fiddle.
Mm.
And there's another older gentleman that went to church there, G.K. Brumble, and he plays guitar and does some older stuff. And I think, I don't know if Fred and his wife ever were members of the Baptist church there or not, but anyway, we reached out to Fred and he took off work and came over in the middle of the day and played with us. Super guy.
Fred loves music. He'll drop everything to play music.
Super guy. Mm-hmm. So that's how.
And he'll do anything for you, not music related too. He's like that. There's a lot of people that say they're Christians, but not everybody acts like one.
Yeah, he lives it.
You know, he acts, and my daddy's one of them too. That, you know, he don't, but he, like if you need him, he's the one you call. He's the one everybody calls.
Yeah.
And Fred's like that.
Yeah, he is. But we did several things over there. We've done a fundraiser too over there, raising money for things in the community. Mm-hmm. And Fred was always a part of that. So
yeah,
that's how I met Fred.
He's good. He's hard to beat. And he's a fine fiddle player.
Oh, he's a good musician.
Yeah, he is. That's for sure. Yeah. Good mandolin picker.
Yeah.
Guitar player.
Yeah.
Not much of a banjo picker though.
Well,
sign of a good musician.
He didn't want to get shot. I guess you can piece this in, but you were going to a festival one night at Fred's and we were running shorthanded and Harold Lynn showed out that night and you missed it.
Mm.
He played guitar, he played mandolin, he played piano.
Really?
And he played fiddle.
Harold Lynn did all this?
He did.
I didn't know he could play all that.
He's been holding out on you, hadn't
he? Yeah, he has.
Yeah. Mm.
He's impressed. And his vocals, I mean, he's an impressive singer.
Oh, yeah. He's excellent.
Yeah, now there are some people who can do all them, can play all those things, but his singing, I think, is better than anything he plays.
Yeah, he's a great harmonizer.
He is great. Yeah.
Yeah.
He's hard to beat. And he can go up into the stratosphere.
Oh, yeah. Bad high. Bad high.
He can just keep going up. And when I'm singing falsetto, just coming from singing family harmony, I can go way up. But there's a limit. There's a cap. And I don't think he's had found his
You wonder where his cap is. Yeah. He can hit the higher notes on Go Rest High on That Mountain than Vince Gill.
He can.
Who wrote it.
Yeah.
So.
And natural, too. Not like straining high.
No.
It's an easy high.
Yeah.
Like a Jim and Jesse.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's an easy high.
Exactly.
What about redneck, white socks, and blue ribbon beer?
I can't remember the words of that.
I love that song.
Jimmy Rogers.
Mm-hmm.
I got a barrel of flour lawn, I got a bucket of lawn. I got a barrel of flour lawn, I got a bucket of lawn. Ain't got no blues, got chickens in my backyard. I got corn in my crib and cotton growing in my patch. I got corn in my crib and cotton growing in my patch. I got that old hen sitting waiting for that old hen to hatch. Play it, Anthony.
Yeah, all them songs. I was playing one of them the other day, Jimmy Rogers songs. And it's Oh, I was. I remember what it was. It was in E. It was. It was a that blue yodel number four. It was a. Well, she's long. She's tall. She's long. She's tall. She's 6 feet from the ground. She's long. And it, the second verse, is she got eyes like diamonds and her teeth shine just the same. But the third verse is, every time I see you, woman, she's always on the street. Every time I see that woman, she's always on the street. Working that corner like a police on the beat. Hoodley, hoodley, hoodley.
Hey, you need to yodel.
Work in that corner like a police on the beat.
You need to do that for daddy. He likes to yodel. I don't yodel. Let's see. He had some good stuff.
Now, does your daddy play any music?
No.
And your mama doesn't play any music?
No.
They don't sing. They don't play.
No.
That's pretty strange that you
they did a lot of listening.
did you start playing? Like, did you play when you were a kid?
No.
So it was a teenager, late or even older than that.
Oh, yeah. I was almost 50.
You were almost 50 when you started playing music? You were singing before that, though?
Not really. In church, really? Maybe, but not playing.
You have unnatural gifts then, because most people don't ever get as far as you.
Well, I wanted to be a part of something. I'd quit hunting and fishing. So.
It's a good thing.
Gosh, I wish I could think of what the name of that dang song was. I had a dream last night. Thought my good gal had gone. And I woke up this morning. She really had done me wrong. Well, I know it's not fair. But my good gal has done caught air. And I'm going away, I'm leaving today. I'm gonna bring my baby back. If that eight-wheel driver don't jump the railroad track, I'll take her from that man. I'm gonna bring her home if I can. My gal's been trifling round about a week, I know. Well, several of my friends done told me so and so. Take her from that man, gonna bring her home if I can. But all I remember then, that's old Jimmy Rogers.
Yeah, that's like all the country music forever was based on those 50 songs that he did.
Yeah.
Like all of it. And then now it's not, doesn't seem like it is anymore. Now it's kind of a mesh of some hip hop.
Yeah. And if I'm listening to him, I like his stuff, but I like it when Merle Haggard does Jimmy Rogers.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, I'm the same way. I'd like to learn them from, I like listening to Jimmy Rogers do them. But I'd like the bluegrass version, or I like the Merle Haggard version, or the Hank Thompson version.
Yeah.
Yeah, their versions are better. They're cleaner, and they're and it probably has something to do with the recording equipment and musicianship.
That's the number of instruments.
Right,
it just makes a difference.
Yeah, it does. Well, thank y'all everybody for watching me and my friend Marty. I know you've enjoyed it because I've enjoyed it. I'm not sure if he has or not, but we've enjoyed having him. And I'm telling you, I'm a little skewed because I'm used to his mom and daddy being around, and they're a lot better folks than he is, and I think he'd agree. So.
True.
But thank you for coming, being a part of this, and we privilege. We enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Play something.
I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.